Much of my life has been marked by grief. When I was a teenager, I remember this night that I was watching some sports, and my father came in the room and reminded me that I needed to do the laundry. And I was like, yeah, I'll get to it at the commercial. This is a big game, and I need to pay attention to this game. So can I do it at the next commercial? And he said, okay. And 20 minutes went by or so, and then he came back in and he said, hey, I still see that laundry there. Are you going to take care of the laundry? And I said, oh, yeah, I forgot. This is a big game. It's the playoffs. And he got a little bit annoyed, but it was okay. And then he went out of the room, and about 30 minutes went by, and he came back in. I was still watching the game, and what do you think about the laundry? Yep, it was still sitting there. And I remember that night because when he saw that laundry sitting there a third time, he had had enough. And we got into this argument, and he went to his room, and I went to my room. In the middle of the night, I got a knock on the door, and it was one of my family members saying that an ambulance was coming, that my father had had a massive stroke in the middle of the night, and he was taken to the hospital. The next day, I think it was the next day, he was declared brain dead, and that was the last conversation I've ever had with my father. And as a teenager, since then, I have been just marked by grief and marked by this feeling of I've suffered this loss and I don't exactly know what to do with it. And I've talked with people and I've gotten help along the way, but it's still there. It's not as prevalent as it used to be. It's been almost 30 years ago now since that happened. But I still remember that night as if it was just a recent memory, even though it's been a long time. Now, I don't know what season you're in or what you're facing or how you're feeling, but during this pandemic, the reality is that all of us are suffering a certain amount of loss. There's a certain amount of pain that we feel and low underlying agitation. And it just feels like life isn't the way it's supposed to be. And we know that that's true. This isn't the way it's supposed to be. But then it gets compounded when people around us die. Now, I, just as a person, and then you add on being a pastor, I see the numbers of deaths in the United States and around the world through this pandemic. And regardless of what your feelings are on what's going on and if the country should reopen or whatever those feelings are, just set that aside for a second. The reality is that in the United States alone, over 50,000 people have lost their lives. That number is astonishing. The whole world stopped in its tracks when 9/11 happened. And that was a horrific event where thousands of people lost their life. And now in this pandemic within the United States, we have more than 10 times that number of people who have lost their lives to this virus within the United States just over the last few months. And I fear that we're getting really desensitized to the math of loss. And yet we can't hide from the fact that life has changed, even if it's for a temporary period of time. Life has changed and we're feeling a sense of loss. Within the church that I pastor, within the last few weeks, we've lost two young women who have died far too young. One in her 30s and one just this past weekend in her 40s. And I want to pause today and just talk about some basic things that I've learned over the years about grieving and things that I need to continually remind myself of. And my prayer and desire is that this is helpful for you even today over these next few minutes. And so the first thing that I want to just bring to your attention is that nobody wants to say goodbye. The scripture says that God does not delight in death at all. It's a consequence or a result of the curse. And we feel that loss. It's true that those who pass away into eternity, who know Christ as Lord and Savior, that we are to celebrate that the pains that they have gone through in this life are over and they're with Jesus. And that gives us some comfort. And yet the reality is that we who are still here still have that sense of loss. And none of us want to say goodbye. It's hard for us to say goodbye, especially when people die around us and we're close to them and we love them and they loved us. And I think specifically about the people that I know, these women in our church, who they leave behind husbands, they leave behind children, and that is something to mourn. That's something to grieve. And as we think about grieving even further than that, there's something within us that wants to hide the grief and say, this is going to be a quick process. We're just going to get through it. Maybe we'll get busy. Maybe by doing things, maybe if I provide this gift or send this card or do this task or take care of this, that, or the other, which are all good and worthwhile things to do, it still doesn't take away the pain. It makes us feel good for a moment, but yet there's still that sense of loss that's there. And it's true that we need to understand that grieving takes time. There is no microwave process with grief. And in the time frame that we're thinking about grief and we're thinking about the people that we lost, we're going to think about all sorts of memories with them. And so those memories could be joyful memories. They could be memories that make us laugh or memories that make us cry or just different ways that people in our lives who we've lost have marked us. And it's good to recall those memories and to share those memories. And as we do that, we're bringing to light what is so easy for us to suppress and push down. It's super healthy for us to talk about the people in our lives that we've lost with the people who are still here and share those moments, share those memories. That is good, that's healthy, and that honors the people who we've lost. They have made a significant impact in our lives in different ways, and we want to celebrate them with the people around us. And so by celebrating their lives, we help that grieving process progress in a healthy manner. We never totally get through the grieving, but the grieving process of that pain switches to honoring the person. And we want to see that switch in our grieving process that goes from pain to honor. And as we honor people, we value their lives. That's what honor means, that we're valuing the people who have left us. And they have been significant, and so we want to celebrate them. The feelings that we have, feelings are real. We want to remember that in the grieving process that there's going to be all sorts of feelings that are there. Sometimes our feelings are going to be, hey, I'm generally okay. And other times it's just a floodgate of emotions that come in. And sometimes those emotions just stop us in our tracks, especially as adults. As children, children will mourn in ways that are kind of like a roller coaster. They might have a minute or two of sorrow and crying, and then a few minutes later, they've moved on and they're playing. It's normal, but then they're going to come back to sorrow and questioning, and there's a curiosity that's there, that what does this mean? They know that death isn't the part of the original design, that we are eternal beings, but our bodies do die and we do transition into eternity. And we have great hope in the scriptures and passages like 1 Corinthians 15 that help us in our grief and help us in our sorrows. And speaking of scripture, it's good for us to open up the Bible and look to passages in scripture that talk about grieving. And even in our prayers, even if you're not that comfortable with praying, it's okay to express to God, I'm angry or I'm sad or I don't understand. And why does it feel like you've abandoned me? Where have you gone in all of this? It's very normal to ask those questions. And trust me, God can handle those questions. That's why I like the Psalms, because it's just an honest picture of people who have various emotions that they put before the Lord, whether it's in anger, whether it's in sorrow, whether it's in mourning, whether it's in intimacy in such a way that they say, God, I need you. And grieving has a host of all those emotions at once. And it's good and healthy to cry out to God and say, where are you in this? And even talking with other people, and saying to them, I'm asking the Lord to show up. I'm asking him to reveal himself because this is hard and this hurts. And as we're honest with the Lord and we're honest with each other, it progresses the grieving process in a very healthy way that keeps us from suppressing everything in and saying, no, I'm fine, don't worry about it, I'm fine, I'm just busy, I'm just going to dive into my work. We can try to distract ourselves from the pain, but it doesn't take the pain away. The grieving is still there. And the more that we suppress our feelings and our thoughts and the grieving process, the more harm that it actually does to ourselves. You can notice yourself becoming more irritable for honestly reasons that don't really make a lot of sense. It's just that the pain is down there and it gets to a place where I don't know why I feel the way I feel, but this is hard, and it's easy to take it out on the people around you or to really self-reflect in ways that aren't all that beneficial or healthy. I love that in 1 Corinthians, we see a picture of Paul talking about our God being a God of great comfort. In 2 Corinthians 1, 3 to 4, Paul says to the church in Corinth, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." I don't know why I've gone through all of the different grieving process that I have with various people, starting with my father and then other people that I've known, whether that's been friends who have died far too early or others who have been a part of the church. But in that process of grieving, I have found that my journey has been useful in helping other people. I'm not an extrovert by any stretch of the imagination, but I'm willing to step in and be with people in the midst of their pain. As awkward as it can be at times, I know that the presence of us sitting there with other people in a sense represents the presence of God in showing this type of comfort that he gives to us in our pain so that we can give that comfort to other people too. And I'm encouraged by the fact that when we lose people around us, it's not in vain. It actually is a process that refines us, honors the person, and helps people along the way as they suffer the loss of people in their lives too. Remember, everyone's journey is unique. No one grieves exactly the same way. Everyone's process is different in when they hit their highs of this is intense and I just need to talk and it feels like I'm just gonna explode. And while someone might be there, someone else might be just in a very different place at that time and not feel comfortable of talking about it. Everyone's process is different. And if you are grieving with people in your home, they may very well grieve differently than you. And so trying to be patient and understand that how they're feeling is coming through and how they're communicating, and maybe even in ways that they are joyful when you're not or irritated when you're not. Yet you're in it together, and that patience and being able to talk it out with one another can be very, very helpful. Finally, I'm really encouraged by Revelation 21. I love how the end of the Bible talks about that this life isn't all there is. I love that there is a picture in Revelation 21 that is just so clear about what God has prepared for us. Jesus said that he is making all things new. And in us now, he's making those who trust and believe in Christ, making us new from the inside out. He's refining us as his people, but he's also making creation new. Romans 8 says that all of creation is groaning to be made new. And as we look into a passage like Revelation 21, we see how God is making all things new in a very specific way. It says, "I heard," this is John speaking, "I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with men. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. I'm glad that there's a day coming where all of the former things of this life, the pain, the sorrow, the crying, the weeping, the loss, the death, all of the disease in this world that's a part of living in a world that's broken and under a curse. I am thankful, as I'm sure that you are too, that God is working on our behalf. He is creating a new heavens, a new earth that we long for and that we anticipate with great joy. And so in the midst of the current pain, in the midst of the current grieving of the pandemic, or in the season, if you've lost someone that's close to you, like I have, remember, yes, we want to honor them. Yes, it's normal to have all of the range of emotions that goes with grief. We will get through it, but it is a moment by moment process in getting through it. And as we get through it, we will get through it with great hope, and we will get through it with a vision that is clear of the world that is to come as Christ is making all things new. Our Heavenly Father, as we spend this time together and we contemplate these things, God, I pray that you would be honored, that you would be valued in our thinking, that we would rely on you and that we would trust in you for the hope that we have only from you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.